Hello and a very warm welcome to Rajya Sabha Television. You're watching a brand new edition of World Panorama with me, Frank Rausan Pereira. Over the next half an hour, we'll bring you a roundup of all the significant events to have happened around the world this week. But first, a look at the headlines. The battle begins for Hodeidah, Yemen's lifeline. UN rejects plan to demand immediate ceasefire in the port. Impasse means Saudi-UAE coalition can continue direct attack on the city. Yesterday's conflict doesn't have to be tomorrow's war, says US President Donald Trump after historic summit with Kim Jong-un. Both signed joint agreement. US pledges to provide security guarantees to North Korea. Kim commits to denuclearize Korean Peninsula. Global community welcomes talks between Trump and Kim in Singapore. India says resolution to the North Korean Peninsula issue will address its concerns about Pyongyang's proliferation links with countries in its neighborhood. FIFA World Cup extravaganza kicks off in a colourful ceremony. Singer Robbie Williams enthralls Russians' 32 teams to battle it out over the next month for the coveted trophy. Well, the UN Security Council has rejected a move to demand an immediate end to the fighting around the strategic Yemeni port of Hodeidah, despite warnings from aid agencies that an attack could jeopardize vital aid to a country on the brink of famine. The 15-strong body failed to agree to a statement calling on forces led by Saudi Arabia and the United Arab Emirates to implement a ceasefire, with the US and UK both voicing opposition to the text introduced by Sweden.
The International Committee of the Red Cross warned on Wednesday that the situation in Yemen is deteriorating and called for all sides in Yemen's war to protect civilians after the Saudi-led coalition launched an air and ground assault on the vital Red Sea port city of Hodeidah. This is the largest battle of the war, aiming to bring the ruling Houthi movement to its knees at the risk of worsening the world's biggest humanitarian crisis.
Today we are at a point where catastrophic is becoming an understatement. The humanitarian situation will depend on how this battle is driven and then how much respect for the international humanitarian law is shown by all the parties. Today we are also at a point where we fear that scores of civilians, tens of thousands of civilians will be displaced in Hodeidah. We are also very concerned that the water infrastructure and then the electricity infrastructure will be damaged, which will be detrimental to the population of Hodeidah.
The Red Cross is calling on all parties to do everything to protect civilians and respect the international humanitarian law.
The International Committee of the Red Cross is calling today all of the parties fighting this fight in Yemen to abide by the rules of war, to protect the civilians that are caught in the middle in Hodeidah. Those who wish to leave to go to safer areas should be allowed to do so. Those who stay in Hodeidah will be still protected by under the international humanitarian law. We urge the parties to protect the infrastructures, to protect the hospitals, and to allow aid in.
UN refugee chief Filippo Grandi said the escalating violence could lead to a refugee exodus and will not end a war that has taken a huge toll on civilians.
It's very unpredictable. You know, in a way, and let me be frank, it's actually surprising that an exodus has not happened yet. Last year we were very worried. We saw a slight increase of people crossing the sea towards Djibouti, but it didn't prove to be a massive exodus. The reality is that, you know, the fundamental question here, and the Hodeidah attack puts that question back on the table very forcefully, is there a military solution, a military outcome to this crisis? We remain persuaded that there is not. And therefore, we will see how this new military develop development continues, but I'm very worried that that will not put an end to the conflict, and therefore there will continue to be pressure on civilians. And that pressure has been terrible.
The United Nations says 8.4 million Yemenis are on the verge of famine, and for most, the port is the only route for food supplies. Yemenis already struggling through the world's biggest humanitarian crisis fear a cutoff of aid.
Taking over Hodeidah could be called an act of madness in every meaning of the word, because Hodeidah is a city full of civilians and it holds the main artery for all Yemenis in north and in the south. 70% of all humanitarian assistance comes through Hodeidah port, and therefore this aid will stop. The battle in Hodeidah will result in a humanitarian disaster in terms of food supplies. Generally speaking, it will be a huge disaster because it is considered the main outlet for Yemen during this period for the residents of Sana'a and residents of other Houthi-controlled provinces.
A Saudi-led alliance of Arab states launched the largest assault on Yemen's war on Wednesday with an attack on the country's main port city, Hodeidah. Coalition warplanes and warships pounded Houthi fortifications to support ground operations by Yemeni troops amassed south of the port of Hodeidah in Operation Golden Victory. The assault marks the first time the Arab states have tried to capture such a heavily defended major city since they joined the war 3 years ago against the Iran-aligned Houthis who control the capital Sana'a and most of the populated areas. Bureau Report, Rajya Sabha TV.
Well, joining me for a chat this week to talk about this is former diplomat Neeraj Srivastava. Ambassador, thank you for joining me on the program. What are the circumstances that have led to this new military development in Yemen?
The circumstances are that the Saudi-led coalition, which is backed by the United States, Britain and France, they have been trying over the last 3 years to capture all territory in Yemen. Unfortunately, they have not been able to do so in spite of indiscriminate bombing, in spite of causing large-scale humanitarian disaster. They have not been able to overcome the Houthis, who are indigenous to Yemen, who belong to Yemen. So now what they are trying to do is to attack the major port through which the relief supplies come in for the civilian population of Yemen. Now this port is located in an area which is controlled by the Houthis. So I think these countries, Saudi Arabia, UAE, United States, Britain, these countries think that if they can control this particular port, then they can choke, you know, the Houthis into surrender. But the problem is that if they, you know, if this port is closed, it will cause a very big humanitarian disaster. Already, Yemen is a huge humanitarian disaster.
The situation is terrible in Yemen as it stands at the moment. So if this port is attacked, bombarded, pounded over the next few days, it's going to be terrible news for the Yemenis, isn't it?
Absolutely. You know, even without this offensive, the situation in Yemen was very bad. Ever since the Saudis started their attack in March of 2015, and now this is June 2018, so more than 3 years. In these 3 years, the Saudis and the UAE, and helped by the weapons supplies from the US and UK, they have bombed large areas of Yemen. They have killed innocent civilians on a massive scale. There is already a humanitarian disaster in Yemen, which unfortunately is not being reported very much because there are no correspondents present there.
Right.
The situation
is
so bad.
Right.
Some people have called it the forgotten war, you know. It is because it doesn't come in the headlines. And I'm very pleased that Rajya Sabha TV is, you know, focusing on this issue. Because, you know, unfortunately, Yemen, because it doesn't have oil, you know, it doesn't have any great resources. So not many people are really interested in what is going on there. But the fact is that outsiders are interfering in a situation which is basically domestic.
Right.
Houthis are natives.
You know, that brings me to my next question, Ambassador. Yes. Who's going to be held responsible for the catastrophe in Yemen?
Well, the world is run in by power politics. You have already seen that the UN Security Council has refused to adopt a resolution. Why? Who opposed it? The United States opposed it, the UK opposed it. So, because, you know, the powerful countries control the narratives of our time. They control the media, the television, everything. So, nobody will really pay for it. You know, those people can keep dying in very large numbers. But I think nobody will live, very few people will even see this on their television screens. Because the corporate mainstream global media has forgotten this war.
So what is the solution then, Ambassador? What is the solution to this problem that, you know, the Red Cross is calling catastrophic?
The solution is that those countries which have no business to interfere in the affairs of Yemen, countries like Saudi Arabia, countries like the UAE, helped by US, UK, they should just get out of Yemen and leave the Yemenis to solve their own problems. I am not saying that if they leave Yemen, you know, tomorrow there will be peace in the whole of the country. No, that's not true. But what I am trying to say is that this is, in a fundamental sense, this is an internal Yemeni problem which should be sorted out by the Yemenis themselves.
But the Saudis have been suggesting, the Saudis are also saying that it is because of Iran that we have involved ourselves in this particular war. If Iran stays out of it, we will stay out of it, because they believe that the Houthis are being supported by the Iranians.
Well, fact is, I have not yet heard of any Iranian aircraft bombing Yemenis. I have not yet heard of any Iranian troops fighting in Yemen. Iran may be supplying some humanitarian supplies. It's possible that it is also supplying some weapons to the Houthis. But to say that the Houthis are totally controlled by Iran, or that Iran is deeply involved in Yemen and so the Saudis have come into Yemen, is not correct. Iranian involvement is not comparable in any sense to what the Saudis are doing and what the UAE are doing. Their troops are fighting inside Yemen.
Right.
But we haven't heard of any single Iranian troop so far. We haven't heard of a single Iranian plane bombarding Yemen. So I think the Saudis are being paranoid.
They
are,
sure.
But I think for them, Iran is just an excuse. The fact is, they have a common border, long common border with Yemen. And they just want a puppet government in Yemen. And they are paranoid that these Houthis, who belong to a sect of the Shias, as soon as the word Shia comes in anywhere, the Saudis immediately start looking for Iran behind them.
Right.
And I'm afraid they're committing the same mistake this time. And the people who are paying for that mistake are the innocent civilians.
Of Yemen. All right, we'll have to leave it at that, Ambassador. Thank you so much for joining us on the program and putting things into perspective for us. On that note, of course, we'll slip into a short break, but we'll be back with all the other international news and news from Russia, where the FIFA World Cup is underway.
Watch Political Theatre with me, Vishal Dahiya, at 10 p.m. tonight, only on Rajya Sabha TV.
Tales that inspire. Stories of social change. A salute to diversity. Promoting public discourse. Events that motivate. Inspiring the innovative spirit. Watch Rajya Sabha television documentaries.
Welcome back. You're watching World Panorama with me, Frank Rausan Pereira. Well, Singapore played host to the first ever meeting of the leaders of the United States and North Korea in 70 years. In the meeting, Kim Jong-un affirmed his firm commitment to complete denuclearization of the Korean Peninsula, while the U.S. gave North Korea security guarantees. After the meeting, Donald Trump said that the U.S. is prepared to start a new history with North Korea.
A historic handshake that ended a 70-year drought in diplomatic ties between the U.S. and North Korea. The meeting began a new era of strategic ties between the two countries, with both U.S. President Donald Trump and the North Korean dictator Kim Jong-un agreeing to work towards complete denuclearization of the Korean Peninsula in return for security guarantees from the U.S. Kim Jong-un reaffirmed his commitment to complete denuclearization of the Korean Peninsula. Trump, on the other hand, promised to provide security guarantees to North Korea. He also said the U.S. will end joint military exercises with South Korea. Both sides also committed to recovering prisoners of war and missing in action, including immediate repatriation of those already identified. They also called to build a lasting and robust peace regime in the Korean Peninsula.
Both want to do something, we both are going to do something, and we have developed a very special bond. So people are going to be very impressed, people are going to be very happy, and we're going to take care of a very big and very dangerous problem for the world. And I want to thank Chairman Kim.
오늘 역사적인 이 만남에서 지난 과거를 겪고 새로운 출발을 알리는 그 역사적인 문건에 서명을 하게 됩니다.
Singapore played host to the first ever summit between Trump and Kim, a summit that was keenly watched the world over. Two rounds of meetings were held between Trump and Kim at the Capella Hotel in Singapore's Sentosa Island. The first one was a one-on-one meeting that went on for 45 minutes. It was followed by delegation-level talks. Both leaders also had lunch together amid the meetings. Donald Trump described the meeting as fantastic, honest, direct, and productive. He also called Kim very smart, adding that the United States is prepared to start a new history with North Korea. Trump, however, said sanctions on North Korea for its nuclear test will remain for now.
Well, it's going to be achieved by having a lot of people there. And as we develop a certain trust, and we think we have done that, Secretary Pompeo has been really doing a fantastic job, his staff, everybody. As we do that, we're going to have a lot of people there, and we're going to be working with them on a lot of other things. But this is complete denuclearization.
The camaraderie was for all to see, Kim arriving 7 minutes early to show respect while Trump wore a red tie, the color of the North Korean flag. The 71-year-old Trump said the summit worked out far better than expected and he has developed a very special bond with 34-year-old Kim. He also said that he will invite Kim to the White House at an appropriate time and will also visit Pyongyang. Akhilesh Suman's report for Rajya Sabha TV.
Well, as U.S. President Donald Trump and North Korean leader Kim Jong-un signed an agreement committing the two leaders to establish new ties, countries across the globe welcomed the meeting, calling it historic.
Thank you very much.
Various countries, including India, welcomed the talks Trump and Kim held in Singapore. The External Affairs Ministry said it hoped any resolution to the North Korean Peninsula issue will address New Delhi's concerns about Pyongyang's proliferation linkages with India's neighborhood. China also welcomed the talks between the two nations. Chinese Foreign Minister Wang Yi said it will continue playing a constructive role in promoting the denuclearization on the Korean Peninsula and it is equally important to take into consideration security issues in North Korea.
<音><音> 朝鲜方面的
Meanwhile, South Korean President Moon Jae-in welcomed the outcome of the summit and called it a historic event that ended the last Cold War conflict. He praised Trump and Kim for their courage and determination.
우리에게 완전한 백화와 평화, 남북미 간의 새로운 시대를 열어주는 성공적인 회담이 되기를 국민들과 함께 간절히
Japanese Prime Minister Shinzo Abe welcomed the joint statement signed by Trump and Kim as a first step in the denuclearization of the North Korea.
北朝鮮には 豊富な 支援 と 勤勉な 労働力 があり 正しい 道を 歩めば 北朝鮮は 明るい 未来を 描くことが できます 今後とも 北朝鮮に対して
UN Secretary General Antonio Guterres called it an important milestone and urged all those concerned to seize this momentous opportunity. He also offered UN help to achieve the goal of dismantling North Korea's nuclear weapons program. Bureau Report, Rajya Sabha TV.
Well, soon after the historic meet, Russian President Vladimir Putin was the first to send an official invite to North Korean leader Kim Jong-un for a visit to Russia. Putin also welcomed the meeting between the North Korean leader and U.S. President Donald Trump. During a meeting with the North Korean official in Kremlin on Thursday, Korean official also handed a written message to Putin from Kim Jong-un. Well, and now let's bring you some colors and flavors from the Football World Cup in Russia. Well, team loyalty apart, fans will also be closely watching out for several key players from the 32 teams. While we cannot decide which are the best ones, here are our top 10 picks. For best players in the World Cup.
It will be the first World Cup in Europe since the 2006 tournament in Germany. The Russian edition will see some of the biggest names in football who can turn the game around and have the capability to lift the World Cup. Some of the key players are Lionel Messi, Cristiano Ronaldo, Neymar, Toni Kroos, Isco, Luis Suarez, Gabriel Jesus, Kylian Mbappe, Timo Werner and Mohamed Salah. Argentina's football sensation Lionel Messi has been scoring goals for his side for over a decade now and has scored 64 goals in 124 international appearances. He's also the top scorer for Argentina and has been World Player of the Year 5 times. Although he has proved his mettle time and again for Barcelona, still a major achievement with Argentina is missing. Another big name in this year's World Cup is Portugal's Cristiano Ronaldo, one of the most dominant figures in football, who has won all possible cups at club level. In 2016, he guided his nation to the first major title in its history to claim the Euro Cup. He also has the most international goals at 81 among currently active players from 150 appearances. Ronaldo has scored 5 international hat-tricks and 4 international goals in a single match. Brazil's Neymar and Gabriel Jesus are the two key players in the side who can turn the game at any moment. While Neymar is the third all-time top scorer for the Brazilian team with 55 goals in 85 appearances, Jesus has scored 10 goals in 17 appearances. Timo Werner and Toni Kroos are two German players who will play a key role for their side. Werner has scored 8 goals in 14 appearances and is one of the youngest talents in the German side. While Kroos was part of the World Cup winning side in 2014 and became the first footballer born in East Germany to win the competition. He has scored 12 goals in 83 international appearances. Spain's Isco, who is often described as one of the best attacking midfielders in the world, has been spectacular to watch not just for Real Madrid but also with the national team with 10 goals in 26 appearances. Uruguay's Luis Suarez took his team to the semi-finals of the 2010 World Cup in South Africa and in 2011 helped his side claim the Copa America title on Argentinian soil. With 51 goals in 98 appearances, he's one of the players who has the capability to lift the World Cup. Kylian Mbappe of France is a match-turner who conquered the hearts of all the lovers of French football. He was the world's second most expensive player in football history after Paris Saint-Germain acquired him for 180 million euros. He has scored 4 goals in 15 international appearances. Another big name in the list is Mohamed Salah of Egypt. Forward for Liverpool and the Egyptian national teams, Salah scored 33 goals for the national side in 57 appearances. He was awarded the CAF Most Promising African Talent of the Year in 2012 and helped Egypt reach the final of the 2017 African Cup of Nations. He became the top scorer during Confederation of African Football qualification to help the team qualify for the 2018 FIFA World Cup. For his performances, Salah was also named CAF African Footballer of the Year and the BBC African Footballer of the Year. All big names competing for the title. It will be an interesting World Cup this year. Kumar Abhishek's report for Rajya Sabha TV.
Well, the world's biggest sporting extravaganza is here and we couldn't be more excited. FIFA mania is gripping the world and just like the World Cup anthem, fans are ready to live it up. I'm going to leave you with these images. Enjoy the World Cup and watch out for our coverage. This is Frank Rausan Pereira signing off.
Twice. One life, live it up, 'cause you don't get it twice.